is a foreign country much closer to Britain, though it's not the kind of place where you can take a package holiday, as Graham Addicott discovered when he went down there to find out about it for us.
This is the story of the Principality of Sealand and its absolute rulers, Prince Roy and Princess Joan. Getting to Sealand, as I found out, isn't an easy business. Because it's a foreign country, even if it is only 7 miles off the Essex coast, visitors going by air have to use an international airport. Passport control aren't too bothered, but I was reliably informed customs would display a keen interest in me on my return. By helicopter, it takes between 20 and 30 minutes to Sealand, which on first sight looks like a giant two-pin plug sticking out of the North Sea. Although, for our visit, the natives, led by Crown Prince Michael, were friendly, they do have an effective way of keeping off unwelcome visitors. Two aerial masts block any unauthorised landings. Authorised ones, like ours, require the masts being temporarily pulled down. Sealand doesn't really have any land as such. It's a steel platform standing 60 foot above the water on two hollow concrete legs. It was built by the Navy in 1942 as a lookout post for German airplanes and submarines. 200 men spent their war on it and shot down over 100 planes. However, for the last 14 years, Rough's Tower, as it was called by the British government, has been the independent Principality of Sealand, the smallest country in the world. Its exact status is a trifle confused. The British government doesn't recognise it, but British courts won't act against its occupiers as the structure's actually outside British territorial waters. Its climate, especially in midwinter, isn't exactly hospitable. Winds often reach gale force 9, and landing our helicopter, even on a relatively calm day, stretched the pilot's skill. Security on Sealand is tight. Visitors' bags are taken away and searched. And even though I was being met by the Crown Prince himself, a pistol-packing guard was never far away.
Did you have a good flight?
Lovely flight, very, very good.
Well, calm. Did you remember to bring your passport?
Yes,
okay,
I did.
Okay, well, let's have that. We'll take it inside and stick a stamp in it. Lovely.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, come on, off to you.
Hello.
Passport control in Sealand is a great deal easier than at Heathrow.
Been some interesting places.
But few as unusual as this.
There we are, Graham.
Sealand today is far from the rusting hulk the Navy abandoned in 1946. The original generators have been rebuilt, corridors painted, sleeping accommodations been installed. In fact, all the mod, well, nearly mod cons, have been fitted. However, many things are still fairly primitive. The lift you have to use if you arrive by boat, for instance. On the sophisticated side, Sealand has its own stamps depicting naval heroes of the past, like Sir Francis Drake. It also has its own currency, the Sealand dollar, with on one side the image of Princess Joan, its value is linked to American currency. And a further mark of respectability, the Archbishop of Canterbury's blessing to hold weddings. But even on those happy occasions, guns weren't far away. Today, firearms still play a major role in the life of Sealand. Racks of guns are ready to defend the independence of the island. In summer, 6 armed guards patrol the structure. But in winter, the hostile weather means there's only a need for 2. For many, it'd be unbearably isolated. For Colin Simpson, it's heaven.
Well, there's plenty of room out here. Run round and round. You ain't got to worry too much on shore. You got to keep worrying about the bills and all that. Don't have no worries like out here. Well, it's always something to do, and got my wife here as well, so, you know, tours company, and it's a lot better than being on over there, on Great Britain.
You seem very happy out here, but how long can you see yourself staying?
Long while, very long while, the rest of my life.
You really mean that?
Yes, I'd stay here the rest of my life, willing.
If the fact that Sealand exists at all is strange, the history of the place and of the prince and princess is stranger still. It all began in the 60s.
Well, I'd like to remind you now that you're listening to Radio Essex, the time is 20 minutes before the hour of 2 o'clock. And at 2 o'clock we have the news for you. And
the late 60s were the golden days of pirate radio. The pirates, much to the horror of the BBC and the government, filled the airwaves with rock. And they were phenomenally popular. Entrepreneurs like Roy Bates, an ex-major in the Desert Rats, and one-time owner of the largest inshore fishing fleet in Britain, rushed in to grab a piece of the action. With the assistance of an eager staff of DJs come deckhands, Roy Bates occupied an abandoned sea fort in the Thames estuary, spent £45,000 of his own money, and created Britain's first 24-hour radio station, Radio Essex. In those heady days, the pirates ruled the airwaves and felt they were immune from attack, even by the British government.
Well, I think they left it too late to act now anyway. I think if they acted now, they would lose a tremendous amount of popularity. We're doing a job that's needed. The public want us to do the job. So do businesses. And I think while this demand is here, we'll remain in business.
But the government did act, outlawing the stations. They blew up the sea forts within Britain's territorial limit. Within a year, the flag of Sealand was flying over another outside British waters. Roy's wife Joan, an ex-Miss Southend-on-Sea, was declared princess. Sealand became a principality as the simplest method of forming a new state under international law. Work began immediately, and even in the early, rather Spartan days, Roy, his wife and son Michael dreamt of getting investors interested in building a sea city complete with casino. As yet, that dream hasn't been realised. But in 68, they received a kind of recognition when magistrates refused to try them on charges of using a radio illegally because the island was outside Britain's jurisdiction. Roy and Joan celebrated by creating a new set of stamps emphasising their right to rule.
Mum, what's it like living out here? Describe a normal day.
Well, it's a very different day to the sort of day I would live in England. You have a normal routine. Instead of running a home, you run a fortress.
You don't miss anything about your former, rather comfortable lifestyle.
Well, not now. I did miss an awful lot of things when we first came here because it was very barren. And we didn't have things like electricity and heating. And, you know, I missed my electric blanket and my cookers and nice civilized sort of things, yes. And you do miss the daily papers and little things, but on the whole, I mean, there's nothing. I mean, we're very self-sufficient here now, and not really, no.
Do you see yourself firstly as prince and princess of Sealand or as citizens of Great Britain?
It all depends on the demands, I think. I'm English, or British, and therefore, I was brought up as an Englishman, and this demands a great deal of my loyalty. I don't see a clash in interests at all. I'm also a Sealander, and I wouldn't permit Sealand to do anything to embarrass or be an unpleasantness on the side of Britain. So nothing will ever happen here which is ever going to threaten in England in any way, politically, diplomatically, or in practice.
They might not threaten others, but others have in the past threatened them, as this film, shot by a German TV crew, shows. In 1978, when Roy was away discussing a business deal, his then Dutch and German partners seized the fort by force. They planned to build the sea city by themselves, and news of the occupation was even announced on German television.
As Außenminister der Principality of Sealand,
Thames Coast Guard, Thames Coast Guard, Sealand, you read?
Crown Prince Michael, who was held prisoner for 3 days before being released in Holland, remembers how the royalists carried out a counter-coup against the invaders.
We were going to come back in a boat and try and scale the place in the dark. It was very difficult because, as you can see, we've fortified it and cut away anything people can climb up on, you know. And we were prepared for that, and the weather was too bad. And we were told that they were sending 10 next commandos over, armed with automatic weapons and all sorts of things, to reinforce their position. So we had to come out the next morning at dawn with a helicopter, and we took the doors off the helicopter, slid down ropes about 100 feet above the sea, because we couldn't land the helicopter, slid down ropes, no life jackets or anything, and landed on the top. And as we came down, they were running out of the building, and we got in amongst them, and you know, before they could organize themselves. I think they were debating whether to start shooting or anything. They were armed, of course. And anyway, we managed to get hold of the situation before it got any further.
The leader of the Dutch and German team was himself a Sealand passport holder, Gernot Putz. Still showing battle scars, Putz was tried for treason against Sealand, fined 75,000 Deutschmarks, and only released after 7 weeks imprisonment. Since then, guns have always been present on Sealand. But would Prince Roy really use them?
Oh, yes. Well, no good having weapons if you don't use them, not prepared to use them. It's a dangerous thing if they're required, of course, yeah.
You don't feel that's perhaps irresponsible?
Irresponsible?
No, you...
Now, you know, just a moment. Let's say this straight. The fact that you can sit in a country like England and not walk about with an armed guard around you all the time is the fact that you have people protecting you, which are security people. Soldiers, policemen. This is what freedom has to be protected. Freedom is a very fragile thing. Liberty is a fragile thing. It has to be protected by the people. No good shutting your eyes to it. If you didn't have armed people protecting you, you wouldn't have liberty.
Mom, you're a princess here. When you go back to the mainland and see all your old friends or meet people in general, how do they treat you?
I think the way they've always treated me. They like me, get pleasure out of my title. Use it and enjoy it. That's what it was given to me for. It was, of course, given to me on my birthday as a birthday present. But that wasn't the reason for making me a princess, to be perfectly honest. If you have a principality, you're simplifying the law. You're not having to write lots and lots of law books, which are obviously cost a lot of money and very time-consuming. So to simplify everything, we made it a principality. And also, I am a princess, and I enjoy having fun with the title.
Why did you do it?
Well, I'm not very introspective, really, you know, and I never really look for the reasons why I do a lot of things. I suppose if I was introspective, I wouldn't do anything because of some of the wild ideas I get and the things I do that are a little bit... I suppose I'm a maverick. I do the unusual, and I enjoy doing the unusual.
You enjoy the challenge, actually.
I suppose I do, really.
Yes.
I suppose that's what it is. I suppose it is a maverick, and these sort of things don't just tempt me, they attract me like a magnet, and I just have to do them, that's all.
At night, the view from Sealand can be stunning. Watching the sunset and the flickering lights on the Essex coast, you find yourself almost seduced by Prince Roy's dreams. But then, our approaching helicopter breaks the spell. The couple's plans for a rich, independent city-state being built in the middle of the North Sea become more difficult to believe in. However, as I waited for the helicopter back to the mainland, the actual realization of the couple's dreams seemed less important. Though they've spent 14 years and many hundreds of thousands of pounds, how many people can look back and say they've no regrets?
I'm not going to be the richest man in the graveyard, and I don't care.
Well, I often say to people, you know, I might die rich and I might die poor, but I'll never die of boredom, and that's absolutely true.
Wonderful lights of Essex, Graham Addicott reporting from Sealand. And that's all.